My name is Christoph Arnhelm. I'm responsible for the sales of the solar sputtering targets at Plansee. And I will talk about our metallic sputtering targets. You see here, you all know the different layers in the SIG system. You need the MOLY, the SIG layer, the front contact, and we provide metallic sputtering targets like molybdenum MONA. This is a new material we developed for sodium doping of the SIG absorber, and also copper gallium. First, a small introduction into our company. Plansee is actually a lake, the Lake Plansee, in the middle of the mountains in Tyrol. And the company was founded 91 years ago at this site for the production of tungsten wire for the light bulbs. And the reason why Paul Schwarzkopf, the founder of the company, chose this site was the cheap electricity from a hydropower plant located at the Lake Plansee. Nowadays, nobody would build a factory in such a mountain region. It's clear. So very quick, some facts about the Plansee Group. We have several other companies. I just want to point out the company MOLYMET. We acquired about 10% share 1 year ago. And this is the world's largest molybdenum processor. And so they're having tens of year-lasting contracts with molybdenum mines. So, and by this share, we have now our own pre-material. So our customers have the security that we never ran out of molybdenum or are dependent on Chinese material. So this is a very strategic acquisition. The total turnover is about 1.5 billion last year, and we have about 6,000 employees. So Plansee materials, Plansee is a company around refractory metals. So we have molybdenum, tungsten, this is almost 90% of our materials. Then we have a little bit tantalum, chromium, niobium. So these are the typical refractory metals which we produce. For other industries also, not only for solar, for example, for the glass industry, glass melting electrodes, for power technology, if you want to switch high voltages, you need special materials. For medical technology, X-ray detector components, X-ray targets. If you go to the doctor, there's 50% chance that there's a Plansee X-ray target inside. Also for the semiconductor industry, base plates, lighting industry, and furnace components. So I don't know how many people are aware of the process sputtering or why do you need a sputtering target, and just want to explain the principle of sputter deposition. You have a vacuum chamber, you have a pump, and then you have the target, which is bonded sometimes onto a backing plate for cooling, and here's your glass substrate. And so you want to remove the material, the sputtering material, you want to remove and deposit on the glass substrate to get a thin film. And you do that by introducing argon gas in the vacuum, apply a DC voltage, making a plasma where you have argon ions, and the argon ions are accelerated onto this target material and the atoms deposit on the glass. So this is the principle of sputtering. We supply mainly targets to the TFT, LCD, and touch panel industry. This is our main business. A hopefully growing business is a thin film photovoltaics. So we had a lot of developments and new developments, and we all hope that the SIG technology will grow. And also for the CSP technology supply and for hard coating applications. So these are the sputtering targets we make. So first, I want to start with molybdenum, our main product. We start from in the production in our site in Reut. We start not with the metal powder, but with the oxide powder, molybdenum oxide. We do on-site reduction in a hydrogen atmosphere in two steps to the pure metal powder. And it's very important because then we have also control about the purity. Then we do mixing and then pressing of the molybdenum, doing sintering, which is just like baking, so the density grows to about 95%, and then you have a deformation step, for example, hot rolling, to make a full dense material. So if you buy as a customer a sputtering target, and you look in the microstructure, maybe from outside it looks very similar, but if you look to the microstructure, it can be very different. So you can have such different kind of of microstructures, and I want to explain the first one. This is a sprayed sputtering target. It's produced by spraying, and it's characterized by a laminar structure. And all what you see here, the black dots, this is porosity. Because of the production process, you have porosity of about 10 to 15%. Yeah, only 85% of the theoretical density is possible. You have the laminar structure, and you have a relatively high amount of oxygen. So this is a target which is produced by hot isostatic pressing. So you do pressing and sintering at the same time. And here you can have high densities, so about 95%, maybe a little bit higher. And it's characterized by a very isotropic orientation. And with this production method, you have quite high purity. So and this is the last method I want to present. This is our way, how we produce it. It's pressing, sintered, and deformed. And here you see deformation of the material leads to an elongation of the grains, so they get wider in the rolling direction. So in the rolling mill, they elongate, the grains were elongated, and by this you get really the highest densities of almost 100%. And very characteristic is also the deformed microstructure, which also gives some texture of the material and the highest purity. So purity, this is a big topic for all of the six manufacturers, especially iron is of big concern. And this is a graph which I picked the data from the ZSW, where you see here the efficiency in comparison as a function of the iron content in the sample. And you see that very low amounts, only in the ppm amounts of iron in the six can degrade the efficiency. So it's very important that, of course, your six is clean, there's no iron in the six, but also in the sputtering, in the moly layer, there's no iron. So if you buy a sputtering target, look really on the actual values of the iron, that they are as low as possible. So target geometries, there are two principles. One is a planar target, you saw in this sputtering demonstration. It's very established, and there are many manufacturers for such kind of targets, but the big drawback is the low material utilization. So only 20 to 35% of the material at the end ends up in the film. So you throw away 70% of your material, and this is not very economic. And because of that, for the solar industry, almost all new machines, sputtering machines, are based on rotary magnetons and rotary targets. You can achieve utilizations larger than 75%. And very characteristic is that you have no redeposition, you have higher deposition rate. And the special thing is that you can make it monolithic. That means without a backing tube, and this has additional advantages. And this I want to show in the next slide. So you can make a rotary target in two types. One is classical approach for the ACO targets, for example, you can only do it like that. You have a backing tube, stainless steel or titanium, and then you bond your material on this titanium or stainless steel backing tube. And the bonding material is indium. And indium is very expensive. And for, let's say, a 4 meter target, you need almost 8 to 10 kg of indium. So a huge amount of money is stored in a bonded type target. And also you have a lower utilization because you have to stop somewhere with the sputtering because you should not sputter in the indium layer. And therefore, for the molybdenum, we developed some time ago the monolithic target, which is completely made of molybdenum. So you have additional material to sputter. There's no additional bonding step, so we offer it cheaper than the bonded version. And also very important point is the higher power density, up to 30 kilowatts per meter. So with bonded type targets, you're limited to roughly 20 kilowatts per meter. If you go higher, then indium will melt. And if you indium melt, then you there's no bonding anymore, and your target moves, and so this is not really desired. Also, if you increase the power density, you also have a higher deposition rate, of course, which gives you, to a certain extent, a lower resistivity of the thin film. The higher material utilization compared to the bonded type target is because you don't have the indium layer, so it gives you a few millimeter more to sputter. And finally, lower cost. So for the monolithic molybdenum targets, you have direct contact between the cooling water and the molybdenum. And this is, to a certain extent, you can handle that by additions to the cooling water, some chemicals which stabilize the pH. If you use normal water, pH drops, and you get really a very acidic cooling water. And to make it more easy for our customers, we developed a new coating for the inner diameter, so there's no direct contact between the water and the molybdenum anymore. So you have the benefits of the monolithic target with the high power densities, but you don't have to care about the cooling water so much. So you need less inhibitors, which also gives you lower costs. Now I want to show you some pages about the MONA. The MONA target is developed because you need sodium for the high efficiencies. So on the right side, you see this is a classical approach. You have a soda lime glass, put your moly on it, and then the 6 at high temperature, sodium diffuses out, and you have the sodium in 6, which gives the high efficiency. And we propose the MONA sputtering, the MONA layer, which then makes it possible also to work on any substrate, on stainless steel, on titanium or polyamide or whatever, and a part of the back contact is replaced by the MONA layer. And then during the high temperature step, MONA diffuses into the 6. So this is a concept. And if we compare it to sodium fluoride evaporation, we have the benefits of sputtering. Sputtering has always higher stability of the deposition rate, has a high lateral thickness uniformity compared to evaporation, and also the toxicity of this sodium compound is much lower compared to a sodium fluoride. And here you see how our sodium MONA target looks like. It's a composite material from pure molybdenum and a sodium compound, and you see it here. This is the pure moly, which we also use for our normal moly targets, and in between we have the sodium compound. And we offer it at the moment in 3 different concentrations from 3, 5, and 10 atomic percent of sodium in the MONA target. So the planar target development was finished quite some time ago, but also rotaries need to be developed, and this is also finished. And these kind of targets we only offer bonded because the length of the target is limited, and also there shouldn't be direct contact with water. And these are some slides of a collaboration with the EMPA Institute. In this project, we wanted to show how you should apply the MONA sputtering target to get the highest efficiencies. And you see here, they started on stainless steel foil, then have a barrier layer, this is titanium nitride, then making a moly, a little bit of moly, and then a MONA layer. So the X stands for 3, 5, and 10, and they just sputtered the layer from the 3 different sputtering targets. And you see here on this graph, this is the sodium concentration in 6 measured by SIMS. 1 is the soda lime glass reference sample because you don't really can quantify SIMS correctly. So it's just kind of a normalization. And by increasing the sodium content in the target, you get more sodium in the 6. And the MONA 10 has, of course, the highest content than in the 6 layer. So the concept worked, and now we concentrated how to make the MONA 10 layer in such a way that you get most of the sodium into the 6. And it turned out that that the deposition conditions of the MONA layer and the moly capping layer, they determine strongly how much sodium can diffuse out. And these experiments were performed on soda lime glass with a silicon nitride diffusion barrier for sodium. And you see here, this is again sodium 6 for the MONA 10 conditions. High energy means very dense MONA layer. Low energy means very porous MONA layer. And you see you can tune, you can increase the sodium content index 6 from the same monatein layer by a factor of 7 just by changing the deposition conditions. So there's no additional mona, it's just that the sodium can go out. And here are the electric parameters and the efficiency, and you see, so from here to here, the porosity is getting higher, so more porous structure, and you see you can, from one to another, increase the efficiency, and we ended up with the same efficiency as the lime glass reference sample, which is about 14%. So the last is the copper gallium. Here there are two different ways how you can make copper gallium targets. One is melting metallurgy, casting, so you come from a melt, so this is a phase diagram, and 25 to 30% are the common concentrations of gallium. So if you do casting, you have to cool it down, and you see there are a lot of phases possible, and it's not so easy to control the grain growth very exactly. And you can end up with some parts of the material which has larger grains, some which have smaller grains. So when we come from the lower side, so we do it by powder metallurgy. So we order finely alloyed powder, which has the copper gallium composition of the target, and then, like here, so this is a typical powder of a copper gallium, and this is already the final composition. Then we do a consolidation to make the target, and you see a very homogeneous and fine-grained microstructure, and so you end up with a rotary target segment, for example. And the advantage is very homogeneous microstructure, small grain size, and it's more easily to control the phases. And you see here on this slide, this is a light microscopy picture from a PM target compared to a casted target, and you see here the large grain sizes compared to the PM powder metallurgy method. And also an advantage is if you have a very fine-grained material, your homogeneity of the gallium concentration is very stable. And so this is our substrate. We spotted in our lab a copper gallium, two copper gallium targets. One target is a powder metallurgy target, the other one is the caster target. And we have on the samples three different positions. And in this graph is shown the difference of the gallium content from the thin film to the target. And you see with the powder metallurgy, we have almost the same concentration, so there's no difference in the composition from the target to the thin film. And with that casted target we used, we have a much lower value of gallium and also a dependence on the position. So on this position, there's more gallium, and in this position, there's less gallium in the thin film. So, and for a very homogeneous thin film, the fine microstructure is beneficial. And here you see, after sputtering, the smooth surface of the PM target compared to a rough surface of the casted target. And with this, I conclude the summary for molybdenum. I showed you the production that pressed sintered deformed gives you a low impurity level. Rotary targets have very high material utilization, and monolithic targets gives you a lower cost and higher sputtering power. For mona, I showed you that it's very easily integrable in existing processes just by exchanging a moly to a mona target. And with the EMPA project, this is a proof of concept that you can achieve similar efficiencies like with soda lime glass. And for copper gallium, powder metallurgy gives you homogeneous fine-grain microstructure. Thank you very much.